Okay, let's get started for the day, trying to work out what on earth we're doing, the radon measures and radon integrals. If you remember last time, I'm just going to go over a little bit of the end of last time, hopefully having it make more sense the second time. So remember we defined this class of functions. So first of all, remember this is the compactly supported continuous functions on X, and then we define CCX superscript M to be those functions which possibly have infinite values for which there's an increasing sequence of functions in this compactly supported continuous class that are converging monotonically upwards to that F. And so the sort of the picture to have in mind is a function like this, which is not continuous, but you can find compactly supported continuous functions that are approaching from below. Okay. So we then also had the corresponding CCX lower M, which were these functions that possibly took the value of negative infinity. And there we asked that there was a sequence of compactly supported continuous functions converging down there. And then on those two slightly bigger classes of functions, besides just the continuous ones, we define these upper and lower integrals. The supremum of the actual integrals of continuous functions, compactly supported continuous functions, rather, which are below. Okay? And so that pretty clearly tells us that this upper integral of this blue function here would be whatever the area of that rectangle. Okay? And similarly, we have this lower integral. Defined in much the same way. This theorem of integrals, bigger functions. Okay, so that's all well and good. Let's, before we go further, let's just understand one or two things about these classes of functions. So first of all, let's try this. So if X is a metric space, I just want to put in, I mean, show that some functions actually exist in these classes. And K is compact, then the characteristic function of that compact set is in CCX lower. Okay. So how's that going to go? What do we need to do to show this? We need to find some compactly supported continuous functions which are above this characteristic function, which are converging pointwise down. So you might think about this picture. And from that, pretty quickly come up with I think we just explicitly write down some functions that witness the fact that this characteristic function is in here. Does anyone want to suggest something that's just like this for a general metric space? So what do we want from these functions? Do we want a family of them that are converging pointwise downwards? We'd certainly like on all of them, we'll define them piecewise. We just want them to be identically equal to 1 if X is in the compact set. Then what can we do?
Within a distance 1 of n prime?
Yeah, so maybe we can say that it's 0 if we're too far away. it's going to be important in a moment when we check this function we're defining in bits and pieces really is continuous. This distance really makes really good sense when k is compact. By definition, that's the, well, usually the distance would just be the supremum of the distances to points in k, but actually because k is compact, it's actually a maximum. That is, that distance. Well, no, no, no. So if you're, if so the distance, so if x is in k, the distance from x, oh, sorry, infimum, thank you. Okay, yeah, so infimum, maximum. Great, yeah, other way around. Oh. Minimum. Great. The minimum is actually, okay, the infimum is actually, yeah, so it's a, because it's, great. Sorry. She asking like okay, and then what can we do in between? Well, we can just sort of linearly interpolate between there, just using this distance function. So I think just doing this. Well, it would, in fact, we can write this. It's pretty easy to check that these functions match up at the endpoints of that interval. And then, just using the fact that this is a continuous function of x here gives you that the whole thing is actually continuous, and it's pretty easy to see that this converges downwards to that characteristic function. Because if you have any point that's outside the compact set, it's distance more than 1 over n for some n, and so eventually you need this part of the dependent definition. Okay, so these sets, well, they're there. What else do we need? Yeah, okay, let's maybe move on for a moment then. Let me try and... Oh, so maybe just a general point, I'll say that these handwritten notes that I'm holding in my hand that are clearly all out of order, I am in the process of checking. I got halfway through it yesterday. Hopefully by this evening I'll have something online, and hopefully after that I'll stay ahead of you, but we'll see. Okay, so sorry about the fact that these notes aren't there quite yet. Okay, so we've got that, and then if you recall, what we did last time was we then defined these upper and lower integrals for arbitrary functions in terms of these ones. Try and make things a bit less confusing, a change notation partway through. I put a double star to indicate this is the really extended version. This just takes an arbitrary function from R to R with no conditions whatsoever. But now it might be plus or minus infinity. And it's the function that just sends, well, it's right. This guy here is the infimum. These upper integrals of g. And there was this picture that I tried to draw where we have some completely crazy function, maybe with some discontinuities. And here we're taking an infimum over these not quite so crazy functions here. And then, but then the integrals of those things that we're taking the infimum over were in turn defined by a supremum over these very nice functions, the compactly supported continuous guys, that were smaller than it. So that was the picture that took. We're taking a supremum as that red line goes up to the blue line, and we're taking an infimum as that blue one comes down as close as it can to the thing we're actually trying to integrate. Okay. And since I wrote it last time, I'm not going to write it all out again, but I'll just say similarly for this lower integral of anything at all, you use the supremum of these lower integrals. Just do the same picture from the bottom. Okay. So maybe sort of the first fairly obvious fact, maybe a few facts here, is that if f is in CC x upper m minus f is in CC x lower m, okay, and the upper integral of f, so this is this sense of upper integral, you can see pretty easily is the same as minus the lower integral of minus f, and then sort of following on from that, for any function at all, you have sort of the same fact for this double guy, that they're related. So, squeeze in here the last definition that I think we got to last time. The L1 functions, the integrable functions, are then exactly all those f's whose upper integrals equal their lower integrals. And then, of course, we just have an integral which will no longer need any stars on it. This now can be a real number, or still plus or minus infinity. Both plus and minus infinity are allowed. And this is defined just by using whichever one of those you please, because they're equal. Let's just give an alternative formulation of that, which will be a bit more useful. Remember, both those upper and lower things are defined in terms of infimums and supremums, and saying that a supremum of something is equal to an infimum of something else is really just saying that you can pick something in the set we were taking this infimum over here, and pick something that in the set we're taking the supremum over here, where the appropriate things are not so far apart. So let me just say that again. We'll say it exactly, so equivalently. These guys consist of all those functions f such that there exist, such that for every epsilon, there exists a G, and these guys, and H, and these guys, that sandwich F in between, so G here, I got the letters wrong, so H is less than F is less than G, and that upper integral of G minus the lower integral of H, the smaller guy, is actually just a very small gap between the upper and lower integrals. Okay. Should we go through unpacking how that? I mean, this is really meant to just be, if you just unpack the definition of supremum and infimum here and here, you're meant to get exactly this. How much to belabor that point. Hopefully it's okay? So before we get hopefully today we'll get to prove some things like all the convergence theorems. Let's see if we can. We need one or two little facts beforehand. So the first one is following. So if we have, so if we have G in CCX lower M and H in CCX upper M, and G is less than, the letters only, so G is less than H, and the lower integral of G is less than the upper integral of H. This is hopefully not so surprising. I mean, g is already less than h, and here we're doing a lower integral kind of thing, which should be sort of even an underestimate of the thing we really care about, and here we're doing an upper integral, which should be an overestimate of what we're really interested in. So it's not really surprising that we get something like that. So let's make sure that we can actually prove that from the definitions. So h minus g is positive. And let's think where it is. Well, actually, it's in CCXN. So let's see, h was already in CCX upper M. Minus g is also in CCX upper M. And the fact that we didn't actually prove is that CCX upper M and CCX lower M are closed under addition and positive scalar multiplication. And we notice, we observed already that there's a, we don't expect them to be closed under multiplying by negative scalars, actually multiplying by minus one is interchanging the two classes. But it's reasonably easy to see straight from the definitions, which are gone now, but just the fact that if you've got two functions in here and there exists these upwards converging limits of complexly supported continuous functions to each of them, you can just use the sum of those two approximating sequences to approximate the sum and so on. Okay, so that's why we know that that goes in there. So now we can just start doing some calculations. We can just apply the upper integral to this. The point is that, oh sorry, change letters. This is a non-negative function, so one of the things that we're taking the supremum over to calculate this upper integral could just be the zero function. So the integral of the zero function is less than the integral of this guy. Okay. And now we just sort of use formal stuff. You can just write that as the upper integral of h plus the upper integral minus g. And that is the upper integral of h minus the lower integral of the g that we started with back in there. Okay.
H.
Sorry, I keep changing letters, don't I? HG, HG, HG. Okay. Great. But that's exactly the conclusion, that the upper integral of H was even bigger than the lower. Okay. So we're safe enough there. And then, fairly easy consequence of that is that the corresponding fact hole, well, no, I guess a corresponding fact holds. With the arbitrary functions, we have that the double star lower integral is less than the double star upper integral for any function at all. Okay, so whatever this function is. And this is now an easy consequence of that guy in unpacking the definitions. So this one here, remember, is the supremum of these integrals. While that there is an infimum upper integrals of h's. And we get this inequality just by observing that everything in this set here is actually just smaller than everything in that set over there. Okay, so say g is in CCX of M, g is less than equal to f, h is in CCX upper M, and h is bigger than f, then suddenly g is less than or equal to h, and we apply the last lemma. Okay, just everything we're taking the supremum over is less than or equal to everything we're taking the infimum over. Okay, great. but why did we bother going up to this somewhat terrifyingly defined space? The point is, we can prove all of the convergence theorems we want. The monotone convergence theorem, the boundary convergence theorem, the dominator convergence theorem here. And notice still at this point, we're taking a slightly different view than one might usually do, because this gadget, remember, was defined starting from an integral, a gadget that told you how to integrate compactly supported continuous functions. We're going to prove all these convergence theorems sort of over in that world, and still a little bit further down the track is proving that thinking about integrals is the same as thinking about measure spaces. Once we've proved those two worlds are actually just different ways of thinking about the same thing, then we'll have all these corresponding theorems sort of back in the world of studying measure spaces. But at the moment, we haven't made that move yet, and we're working on the other side of things. Okay, so we need two lemmas about integrable functions before we can do any convergence theorems. So first of all, this is a vector space. And I'm not going to prove anything there. It's pretty boring. Remember, the condition here is just that upper double star integral equals lower double star integral. And the point is, you just prove both of these are linear. And so that immediately shows that this set is closed under addition and scalar. So the more interesting fact that lets us do everything is that it's a function lattice, so it's closed under max, which sometimes I'll write as like a little wedge, but I'll try and write max, and min, which sometimes I'll write as a little wedge facing the other way. Okay. This fact is a little bit less obvious. So let's try that now. Okay. So if we have two functions here, let's give ourselves a little bit of room and pick some positive epsilon. And as soon as we've done that, what do we know? Well, remember there was that characterization which I've erased of functions in the integrable functions. If you could find a CCX upper M and a CCX lower M function whose upper and lower integrals weren't far apart. So now what we can do is we can choose G1, G2, CCX upper M, H1, H2, and CCX lower M, so that first of all, the H's are smaller than the F's, are smaller than the G's, but the integrals aren't very far apart. The upper integral of GI minus the lower integral of HI, that's some positive quantity. This function is bigger than that function, that's an upper integral, that's a lower integral. But we nevertheless get to say that actually those integrals are very close together. So this is the existence of those functions is just that equivalent formulation of what it means to apply to me, someone from somewhere in the university wants to talk. It's not so hard from this. We basically now, we've unwrapped the definition of what it means for F1 and F2 to be in this, in L1. And now we just need to show that max F1, F2 is in L1. Okay, so to do that, so we want that the upper integral of the maximum G1 and G2 minus the lower integral of the maximum of H1 and H2 is less than something small. Turns out the small we should aim for is 2 epsilon. Okay, now how can we do that? Well, so this just follows from the fact that if you look at the maximum of G1 and G2, and you subtract the maximum of H1 and H2, that's bounded by G1 minus H1 plus G2 minus H2. So do we need to draw a picture to see what that looks like? So the G's are the bigger functions, so maybe let's draw 2 different G's, a G1 and a G2, and then let's have an H1 and an H2. And so what we're saying is that if you look at the maximum of these guys, so that's the max function there, and that's the max function there, where it seems totally wrong.
What am I doing?
So we're saying the distance between those guys is no more than the distance from... The point is that, at any given point, the maximum here was either H1 or it was either the value of H1 or H2. Assuming the maximum here was either the value of G1 or G2. And therefore, these distances that we have on the right hand side, and that distance there, and that distance there, and I feel like you just have to think about 4 numbers. I'm not sure if we could go through all the cases of these being bigger than or smaller than, but I think you argue this basically just by a case fashion, which one is bigger and which one is smaller, and check that in all the cases it's fine. Okay, so why does that give it to us? Well, the point is just that we can compute the upper integral of all of that. So the I've missed a lemma here that needs to be inserted. CCX, where does it go? Upper N is closed under taking max. So at the moment we're trying to prove that L1 is closed under doing that. But we need this earlier fact here. But this one is not so bad. This one, you just use the fact that if the FNs are converging up to F, and the GNs are converging up to G, you can just use max FN GN, and that converges up to max FG. Okay? And then finally we're using the easiest lemma of all, which is that CCX itself is closed under max. Continuous, you can take the maximum of 2 continuous functions. So that's what shows these guys were still continuously compactly supported. They're converging under there, so you can take maxes here. And so this guy, since both of the g's were in CCX upper M, their maximum is as well, so we're allowed to take that upper integral. And then we get exactly what we want. When you take the upper integral here, you have to take the upper integral of minus this maximum, which is the same as taking minus the lower integral of that maximum, and then you just apply this fact twice on the right hand side. Okay, great. Closed under maximums and Oh, I mean, I only proved maximum here, but this is exactly the same argument works for minimum. You can also actually, you don't really have to repeat the argument for maximum as well. You can write a sort of a linear expression between the maximum and the minimum and the two functions. So you can actually see that once some set of functions forms a vector space and is closed under maximum, it's automatically closed under minimum as well. So you don't really need to run the argument twice if you don't want to. Okay. Okay, let's prove the first of our convergence theorems. Now that we've got all those bits and pieces ready. So then we'll do the monotone convergence theorem first. Somehow, every different possible way of setting up measure theory, you prove these three theorems in a different order. And if you look at the notes that are online already for sort of the conventional approach to measure theory, I think we do it in the opposite order. We start with the bounded convergence theorem, then prove dominated convergence, and finally monotone at the end. Whereas in this setup of how we do measure theory, we're doing monotone first. So, if it's a pointwise limit, a pointwise increasing, it's the point of the monotoneness, of some functions fn, which are all integrable, and the integrals bounded, then we have that pointwise limit is also integrable. And of course, its integral is the limit of the okay, so not at all a surprising statement. It's the statement we've been seeing for a while now, but the statement means something a little bit terrifying when you actually unpack the L1 at this point. Okay. So what do we do here? Okay. Well, since L1 is a vector space, we're allowed to assume that F0 is zero, and all that we do if that's not the case is subtract F0 off everything inside. Prove the theorem, so subtract it off all the fn's and the f, okay? Prove the theorem in that case, and then just see that sort of you could add f0 back on and get the conclusion. So we're allowed to assume that, and then we define phi n to be the successive differences of the fn's. And here, what I want to observe is that gn is certainly still an integrable function, just because it's a vector space, but it's also a non-negative function. So maybe we can just declare this notation for all time. This means if we have any class of functions that we're talking about, you add a little plus subscript on it, it means just the non-negative functions from that class. Okay. So, well, what does that mean? Saying that the gn's are in there means we can pick hn's and ccx upper n, which are bigger than the gn's, but the integrals aren't too far off. Those upper integrals of the h's are at most the actual integral of the gn, plus a very tiny amount that gets smaller as the n's go out. Okay. Then we let h be the sum of all those hn's. Now, H is here. I'm getting to a section of the proofs here where I'm not entirely sure that I've actually proved all the lemmas we need to see all these steps. So let's stop and think if we really know these two facts. So first of all, do we believe that that F is smaller than these H's? Yeah, that's fine. I mean, F itself is just the sum of all the G's. That's just some telescoping series. All the terms cancel in pairs. But the individual HNs are bigger than the individual GNs, so the sum of all of the HNs is bigger than the sum of all of the G's. So that part's fine. The slightly scarier one is here. Why we were... we said earlier that CCX upper M was a vector space. You could take two things in there and add them and still be in there, but now we're taking an infinite sum of them. So we're asserting something stronger now. Okay. So maybe we need to split out a separate lemma about that. So let's see. So I think the thing that we're using here is that, let's use a different letter so we don't tangle them up. If we've got a bunch of infinitely many positive functions in there, then their sum is still there. And obviously it's positive, but that's not really the point, so let me just write it like that. Now why is this going to be true? What does it mean to be in here? Has letter LNM converging up to KN. That's where we're varying M as M goes to infinity, and these LNMs are actually honest compactly supported continuous functions. Okay, so our job from these guys is to come up with something that is obviously compactly supported and continuous, and it converges up to these guys. And how are we going to do that? Well, I think, what can we use? There must just be... it's not quite a diagonal. We definitely want to do something diagonal, but we've got this sum here that we need to do something about. So we're not quite there, but maybe a good way to say it is that this fact tells you that the sum from n equals 0 to some big N of the LNMs converges up as m goes to infinity to the sum from n equals 0 to big N of the KNs. Okay, that's just summing part of the sequence. And so what I want to do now is do a diagonal argument where I sort of use the N and the M at once. And so hopefully, I'll admit I did not think about this as I didn't notice we were doing something a bit evil there. What I want to say is that the sum from N equals 0 to M the LNMs converges up to the sum of all of the K's. Can we see that happening?
I think this may not be fast enough.
Oh, I see.
I have two questions.
Yeah.
One is, so don't we need all the KNs to have the same compact support? Which we do in the theorem. Right. That's certainly true, right? Because otherwise, if we sum them all up, we could just get, they could be non-zero everywhere.
Well, I mean, no, I don't think we need to worry about, I mean, each individual thing we've written down here has compact support. I mean, the Cobec supports are allowed to get bigger and bigger as you take one of these limits.
But like, but we're taking the infinite sum of all the k's.
Well, I mean, this infinite sum, this is certainly not going to have Cobec support.
You've got to be very careful.
With the m there, you lose Cobec support
as soon as
you do this.
Yeah, I mean,
like the constant one function is perfectly fine in here, just because these bump functions that are just getting wider and wider are converging upwards to the constant one function. So there's no need for Cobec support at this level. So that part's fine.
We can choose m, which is a function of n, so that L n m, capital N, is differs by k and by less than epsilon times 2 to the negative m.
Okay. So let's remove that, and let's leave that lemma hanging as a to be continued. If someone feels like posting the argument on Waddle before I get to it, that's great. And otherwise, I'll make sure that we come back to that, or at the very least, I put that step in the notes. Okay. So we are using something a little bit here to make sure that we've still got that. Okay. Okay, but we're not done yet, but we're almost done. So remember, what are we trying to do? We're trying to show that F is actually L1, which means we need to show upper double star and lower double star are equal, and then in fact we know what we'd like them both to equal. We'd like them to both equal this. Okay, so we're going to do this by a squeezing argument. So we take this. So for any number m, we can look at the integral of f sub m. And now, remember, f sub m is in L1, so by definition, that's equal to the lower integral for f sub m. And then we can use just the monotonicity of this lower integral to switch out fm over to m. Okay, these guys are pointwise increasing up to f, so we have that inequality. And then we can jump over to bounding that by the upper integral, okay? And then we can use monotonicity again. So that was, let me fill in some of this explanations. What have we got that's an upper bound for f? Exactly this h that we made here, okay? So that's smaller than the double upper integral of h. And yet another step that now I'm worried about. Let's make sure we come back and think about that one. I want to claim that that's actually just the sum of those integrals at the h ends. That definitely is going to need some justification. But once you've got here, everything is pretty easy again, because what sort of thing was hn? Hn was actually just in ccx upper m. So its double star integral is actually just equal to its single star integral, because in the infimum that defines these things, you can just use hn itself and get that. Now you just use the definition of hn, or rather not the definition, but this inequality for hn. So that's bounded by the sum of the actual integrals of these g's, plus some tiny bit. We've got a sum there so that we get the sum of the 2 to the minus n epsilon, so that just gives us an epsilon. And that's just what it means to say the limit of the integrals of the fn's. Remember, because you can write this f as, rather, when you write the g's in terms of the f's, it's just telescopes to give us exactly that. Still plus epsilon. But now we're really great, because this had just this dangling variable m that we never used. You can take m to infinity, and that says the limit of these guys is less than this, so we get the limit of the integrals of the FMs is bounded by the double star lower integral of f, which is bounded by the upper star upper double star integral of f, which is bounded by this same limit plus epsilon. And then you can, we could do that for any epsilon. So you can take that epsilon to zero and see that all of these numbers actually have to be equal, because they're sandwiched in between this number and itself. So f is in L1. And its integral, which is either of those numbers, is the limit. Okay. What is going on here? So here, this was just that. That steps just the definition of H. And it's that one we need to justify. Okay, so let me realize that I haven't thought about that step either. We've got to make sure we fill in those bits as well. Do you hear me? Okay. How was that? Sorry, I didn't quite get to everything I wanted to get to. Okay, so maybe in the 1 or 2 minutes that remains, let me try and just give you a bit of the big picture of where we're going for the next little while, because I know that these proofs are a bit hard and technical, and it can be hard to keep perspective of where everything is at the moment. Okay, so next up, we need to prove the other convergence theorems, and then we need to extract a sigma algebra from the integral and a measure mu on that sigma algebra, and conversely, define an integral from a measure, and prove these constructions are inverse constructions. So again, that will, we'll obviously need all these convergence theorems for ever being able to calculate integrals later, but they're also, we need them in the midst of these proofs here. So we have to finish off doing the constructions back and forth from integrals to measures and from measures to integrals, check that they really do go back and forth. Hopefully, depending on how much time that all takes, we'll classify all radon integrals on the real line. And these will be what are called the Lebesgue-Stiltjes integrals. And in particular, this will give us a construction of lots of radon integrals on the real line. But that's something that's actually very specific to the reals. Okay, and then other things we need to do are show that all the LP spaces with respect to any radon integral are complete as normed vector spaces using the usual LP norm. And then show that if you take LP and take its dual, so all the bounded linear functionals on LP, we want to show that that's actually isomorphic to LQ. Where here 1 over p and 1 plus q so 1 over p plus 1 over q is equal to 1, and we need p is greater than 1. Maybe we'll, something slightly different happens when p equals 1. There's still a nice relationship between L1 and L infinity, but it's not just that they're duals of each other. It's unfortunately more complicated there. We need to show that this theory is all actually usable. The one sense in which you can judge whether a way that you've set up measure theory is usable is whether you can actually construct interesting measures on interesting spaces. So the maybe thing that we'll do in this course is actually construct product measures. And prove for being Tonelli. For the spaces where it actually works. But what we're not going to do in this course is then go on and prove lots more things, or construct lots more things. But the sort of big examples of things that one would do if you had a bit more time for measure theory are about the Hausdorff's measure on fractals, take back more Banzig's course sometime, or very importantly, Brownian motion, where there's a measure on the space of sort of paths in Rn, which sort of tells you how likely different random walks are. But we're not going to, unfortunately, get to that stuff. But we'll have all of the technical material in place that one can do that. And Brownian motion is actually one example of a nice essay topic if anyone is thinking about things they want to do. Okay, let's stop for the day. Everyone got their assignments back by email, hopefully. I'm happy to discuss, argue, chat about the grading or anything else on those if you're interested in. The next assignment